We've been very clear in trying to point out factual discrepancies between what the Libyan government says and what we see and hear on the ground from our correspondents, from sources, as well as the individuals we speak to, and numerous videos we're able to receive and check. On this program, we always strive to hear alternate points of view whenever possible, and we want to give our viewers facts so that you can come up with your own conclusions. With that in mind, we're pleased to welcome the man who speaks for Muammar Gaddafi, Libyan government spokesman Musa Ibrahim. He joins us from Tripoli tonight. Mr. Ibrahim, thanks very much for being with us. Colonel Gaddafi and his son, Saif, have repeatedly said that they will not kill Libyans and that they're only bombing ammunition depots. Today, our correspondent, Ben Wiedemann, was with a group of several hundred Libyans in Brega, volunteer forces, armed men, when a Libyan fighter jet dropped a bomb on their location. It narrowly missed them, but several people were wounded in another bomb dropping. There was no ammunition depot, according to those underneath the bomb, and it contradicts, it seems, what your government's been claiming. How do you explain that?
Well, we would like to establish here and now that here we are not faced with peaceful movement for political change, Anderson. This is an armed rebellion with people going around attacking police stations, army officers, getting hold of guns and attacking civilians and cities. So this is a very important distinction to make. The Libyan government, they were trying to repel an attack by your government forces,
they say.
This is not true. The movement started very peacefully with university professors and lawyers. We supported that. We wanted this to take us forward peacefully towards a written constitution, freedom of the press, and opening up the country. What happened is Al-Qaeda elements, which your Secretary of State referred to a few hours earlier, took hold of the situation, and they are leading the country into chaos, Anderson, and
okay,
we know very well.
Let me ask you this, because
loves chaos.
Your explanations, Gaddafi's explanations and Saif's explanations, have been all over the map on this. When Saif Gaddafi first went on state TV on February 20th, he said that this was something that was started by many people living abroad on Facebook who wanted to recreate what was happening in Tunisia and Egypt. 2 days later, Muammar Gaddafi goes on television and says actually Americans are handing out RPGs in Benghazi and claims that they're making Libyans crazy and act irrationally. And now you're saying it's Al-Qaeda who's holding the city of Benghazi hostage with a few hardcore terrorists. Our own correspondent in Benghazi, who's been moving around freely, says that's patently absurd. You guys have been all over the map in your explanations.
Absolutely. If you allow me to make the point clearly, we know that the movement started peacefully. What we are saying is that thousands of highly trained Al-Qaeda affiliates who operate in Yemen, Somalia, Sudan, Algeria, and Afghanistan have hijacked this movement.
Where's the evidence,
we
though?
Know,
you've said this
your,
now, but you've offered no evidence.
They have... You know, there is evidence. They have already declared two
Islamic
states.
Where's the evidence? You said Saif went on television days ago and said that he had phone intercepts. We've seen no evidence presented.
We have captured dozens of these people. We have figures. We have interviews. We are willing and prepared to take these people and show them on international media. Anderson, what we are dealing with here is a very dangerous situation for the safety of the international community and especially the West. These people are not the usual religious fanatics. These are young people who are led by Al-Qaeda fanatics. And what they have in common is such hatred for the West that they are prepared to die.
But, sir, that goes against everything that our correspondents... That goes against everything our correspondents on the ground are actually seeing in Benghazi. That goes against everything that I've talked to probably now dozens of people who are trapped in their homes in Tripoli and other places who talk
Anderson,
about democracy and freedom.
If you allow me, the international media hasn't been very transparent and honest about the situation of Libya. They talked about bombardments of civilians, massacres of civilians. We have here 140 civilian, foreign correspondents in Tripoli in this very hotel.
Well, sir, we just saw a bombing directly on Libya.
Evidence. I cannot comment on the individual cases. I haven't checked them yet, but we know that there are gangs of armed individuals moving from Benghazi towards other cities in the east and the south of Libya. They are terrorizing civilians. They are occupying cities.
Sir, Benghazi, away from the government. Benghazi is the second largest city in Libya. Misrata is another large city. If you believe Saif Gaddafi and yeah. your leader, Colonel Gaddafi, they say that in Misrata, 40 to 50 hardcore armed men are holding a city of some 550,000 people hostage. That's what they're saying is happening in Misrata. That doesn't make any sense. And in Benghazi, they're saying the same thing. You cannot hold the second largest city of Libya hostage with a handful of armed men. Arab Ben Wiedemann says this is patently false.
Anderson, what is happening is that the government has been taking a step back to prevent the shedding of Libyan blood. The government can easily take the people in
Misrata. But again, you're not addressing whether or not it's possible that a city of the second largest city can be held hostage by a handful of people. It defies sense. Yeah. It doesn't defy logic.
If you allow me, Anderson, I have the answer. I have the answer for you. If you allow me to speak just, you know, for a short while without interrupting, a city of Azawiya, which is the third biggest city in Libya, is only 50 kilometers away from Tripoli. Your journalists went there. They saw that the main square of Azawiya is occupied by these armed individuals. The Libyan army is completely controlling the city. It could easily wipe out these people. It chooses not to because we want violence to stop. We need tribal intervention, social intervention, to help us convince these people to come to the negotiation table. We have indeed succeeded in getting dozens and dozens of young people to give up their arms and come and talk to us because of tribal and social intervention. We want to do the same in Misrata, Benghazi, Gdabia, and other cities.
The claim I find hardest to understand is this claim that Libya's youth are being given hallucinatory pills and then brainwashed to attack. Again, Gaddafi said it was Americans doing this first. Now he says it's bin Laden. What drugs are being used specifically? What hallucinatory pills?
Actually, the leader did not specifically accuse the United States of America. He really said that Al-Qaeda are very highly trained individuals who now look more secular than the dwellers of the caves in Afghanistan. They wear trainers and jeans.
I'm asking you, what pills? What hallucinatory pills?
Young people to join them against. We did indeed capture young people using those pills to.
What pills? No, I'm asking. Are you talking about methamphetamine? Are you talking about ecstasy? Are you talking about LSD? Are you talking? What are you talking about?
I'm not an expert. We are really now dealing with the matter from all sides. Let me just
your entire argument. Your leader is basing his entire explanation. He says this every time on these hallucinatory pills. It seems to defy logic. You're saying that a small band of terrorists have been able to manufacture, import, distribute huge quantities of hallucinatory pills across vast areas, hundreds of miles apart, to various cities, and then been able to continually drug tens of thousands of Libyan young people so that they will fight? Does that make any sense to you at all?
No, this is not the story. Anderson, this is not the story we are putting forward. This is one element of the story.
But that's the story you mentioned that Gaddafi and his son mention every time they talk.
Situation here. No, Anderson, you have to let me make my point.
I'm asking you what pills. This is a huge part of your explanation. But go ahead.
No, I'm saying to you, and my answer to you is that this is one element of the story. The main core of the story is what your state Secretary of State, Mrs. Hillary Clinton, said only a few hours ago, that Al Qaeda is trying and hoping to send Libya into chaos and disorder so they could have a Mediterranean Somalia only half an hour away from Europe in a vast, vast region of Libya. Libya is 1.7 million square kilometer. If Al-Qaeda gets hold of the chaos here, then this is extremely dangerous to Europe and to the States.
I don't think anyone's arguing that point.
We have been cooperating very wonderfully with the United States. We have been at the forefront of fighting against terrorism. Terrorism now is winning inside.
You've been at the forefront fighting against terrorism?
Give us help.
Did you just say your regime has been at the forefront
in the
of
last
fighting
years,
against terrorism?
We have abandoned. Yes. Yes, and I'll give you the examples, the powerful examples. We have abandoned publicly and internationally our weapons of mass destruction project, which has been presented as a good example to the North Koreans and the Iranians to follow. We have cooperated fully against al-Qaeda activities in Libya and North Africa. Libya is the only country free of al-Qaeda and the region. If al-Qaeda gets hold of this country, then they will link themselves to Egypt.
Well, you claim it's not free. You claim there are thousands of al-Qaeda-related affiliates all throughout your country. But let me ask you, Saif Gaddafi had said that on February 20th, he would provide evidence of this massive drugging conspiracy. He said there are documents and he would provide evidence that it would be forthcoming shortly. I've yet to see anything on these magic hallucinatory pills that again, you're basing a lot of your explanation on, and yet no one's provided any evidence.
I would like to get away from any sensationalist reporting. Anderson.
Sir, I'm responding to what your leaders have said. Is that not sensationalist?
Small element.
What it is ludicrous, and that's why you can't come up with an explanation for it.
But if you take the but if you take the timeshare the leader gave to these pills, it's very small. It's one element that we discovered with young people in the city of Tripoli and other cities. And we are ourselves wondering about these pills. But the story is much, much bigger. What we think, Anderson, is that the international community's reaction towards what's happening in Libya has been not very honest and transparent. The Security Council, for example, Anderson, based its agreement against Libya on media reports. Without Anderson, I mean, you have to look at this very carefully. Any fact finding mission without visiting Libya, without allowing Libya to defend itself in the UN, and the guy who's supposed to be the lawyer of Libya, the representative of Libya, was going against his own country.
Right, they've defected. They've left.
Any representation, no fact finding mission.
Sir, I the reason I bring up the hallucinatory pills is because I think international.
Our new guy.
Right. The reason I bring up the hallucinatory pills is because I think internationally, when people hear that, and again, we hear it every time your leader speaks and every time his son speaks, I think people think that's ludicrous, and they think if he's lying about that and making stuff up about that, then why should we believe other stuff he says? Today, your leader also says that he has no money, that he has no assets, and in fact has no power.
Yes.
That seems to fly in the face of plenty of evidence of, you know, Saif Gaddafi living in a nice house in London and paying pop stars, you know, millions of dollars to perform in St. Bart's. I mean,
Anderson, what people hear in the international media is not the leader keep mentioning the bills. It's the flashes you do, the sensationalist reporting. They leave a 2.5-hour speech and they keep repeating the 1 minute in which he talked about these bills. And they leave out the very important matters he discussed, like democracy, constitution, the discussion and negotiation with lawyers and university professors, the intervention of tribes, the social structure of Libya, the fight against terrorism, the need to move forward with the country, the need to open up to the international community, the welcoming of fact-finding missions. All of these very essential matters they leave out, and they keep having these audio or sound bites from a very small element in the speech. That's what we are faced with, sensationalism in the media. The leader has been around for a long time. He's respected by his people. He moved Libya forward in education, health, transport. You could check the UN indications for Libya in 1970 and now in 2011. And you will see it's a revolution, Anderson, for the people of Libya. We live here very peacefully in a very highly structured society. We have the best of universities, hospitals, transport. And yet, Anderson, yes, we have to move forward. We have to allow for more democratic and transparent system.
Yeah.
We can't do that with an armed political movement against the state and the national unity of Libya.
Mr. Ibrahim.
We need to do that peacefully and in negotiation. We invite, and let me finish with this, please. I invite, in the name of my government, every fact-finding mission possible in the world. All NGOs, governments, are all welcome to check that there are no massacres, non-bombardments of civilians, and that the case in Libya is a case of an armed rebellion against a united country.
Mr. Ibrahim, we gave you a lot of time, and I hope you think we were fair to you. We asked you hard questions. You answered them. We leave it up to our viewers to decide. Mr. Ibrahim, I appreciate your time, sir. Thank you.